Welcome to this ultimate internet hangout where we hear what we won't hear anywhere else because we're very iconoclastic here, which is sanity. Because in a culture that's dedicated to insanity, to be iconoclastic to that is sanity. So we're dedicated to sanity here. I spent the day in a Kaiser Permanente hospital today. Very interesting, say the least. I think a comment that was most telling was one of the nurses said, "We can't do anything that the machines don't tell us to do." And she was a very nice nurse. I sort of were talking and she said this, "Okay, we can't do anything the machines don't tell us to do." I said, "Hey, wait a minute. What's running everything in this world right now? What's running our healthcare? Machines?" Very interesting day. So, welcome to the video here, where we are extraordinarily iconoclastic, which is what we need to hear at this time. Because what we're getting from society may be actually just machines talking to us through people. Keep in mind, what are people actually? People are just an excuse that spirit is making for its own failure to change reality. All of this, the world, bodies, people, personalities, is just a silly excuse from spirit's imagination so it can blame bodies and worlds for its own futility to change reality. There isn't any self-nature to bodies or personalities or this world or anything like that. Now, I had another very interesting experience. Driving home, I drove 320 miles today. I got real sleepy, real tired. I said, uh-oh. And I said, this is a little dangerous. So I had a coffee drink there. So I drank about half of it and it kept me awake. So, but I noticed the effects of coffee. I was just sort of, I was looking at caffeine and saying, okay, what am I wanting to do now? My mind starts going towards, let me do this, let me do that. And then spiritually I said, hey, wait a minute. That's the opposite of what I should be doing. And I realized it was the coffee talking. The coffee is very, very, very much a distorting drug. And I found out that the most dangerous drug in the world is caffeine, for sure. And what caffeine was doing was turning my mind in a certain direction. And then I looked back in hindsight, and I said, oh my gosh, oh my God. This is what it did in the past. I said, wow. And this is what's going on in the world. I'll tell you, it's caffeine and machines that are talking through people right now. And what caffeine does is interesting. It instructs us to empower women, actually. And I said, well, that's great if women are speaking the truth, they're representing the truth. But if they're not representing the truth, why should we empower women? Why should we empower men if they're not speaking the truth? Right? That's crazy. Don't empower those who are advocates for the ego and the egoic lie of self-pretension, whether they're men or women. But I find that caffeine always moves me towards empowering women no matter what. Just a blind empowerment of women. Fascinating, huh? Also, it directed me to go up to San Francisco and do videos up there with a selfie stick. And I thought, well, that's a really great idea. But then I realized, hey, that's really grandstanding, isn't it? I mean, I could walk down the streets of San Francisco with a camera on a selfie stick and do an awesome video. There's no question about it. It would be extraordinary. But what am I promoting? In the background, there's all this darkness, all this machineness, all this egoicness, all the self-delusion. And I don't want to, I'd be grandstanding. That's the last place I'd want to go. So why should I grandstand to try to get more viewers and put myself in jeopardy spiritually to do this? And I was just about ready to do it. And then something told me, said, no. Right on the brink. I said, wow, that's the coffee talking. That's the caffeine talking. That is definitely the caffeine talking. Caffeine, and then the colors I was considering was like, you know, the brownish stuff, which I should take. So let me take some tone off of this. And let me go to more black and white. Let me just go completely to black and white there. We can go just to black and white, which is fine. A coffee is associated with brown tones, dark brown tones, right? You go into a Starbucks, you go into coffee shops. Just look at the color scheme they have in there. That's the coffee talking, actually. Caffeine is a heavy, very, very strong drug, but it's so subtle that we haven't caught up to it yet. I have, but most have not. Now, we know from shamans, shamanism is a very ancient tradition in this world. It's a respectable tradition. I mean, I enough to pay attention to what they're saying. And they say that every plant has a consciousness, and every drug from plants and any extract also has a consciousness. And when you use that drug, that consciousness, you're allowing that consciousness to speak through you, as it were, to control you. And so certainly caffeine coming from plants has its own consciousness and is speaking through us, and our society is reflecting that consciousness of caffeine. It really is. And here this consciousness was directing me to do these things that I knew. I always say that's the last thing I want to do. Don't do this for whatever, no matter what, don't do this. And here caffeine had me right on the brink of doing a bunch of stuff that spirit had told me, don't do this. It's ruinous. It'll be ruinous for you. So we have outed caffeine today. Now, of course, I'm a pragmatist, so I don't want to fall asleep at the wheel, right, of course. But I also said, hey, what if caffeine is instructing me to be tired, so then I can have an excuse to use it? And when I thought this, I felt the ego be very startled. Something within me was very threatened and startled by this train of thought. Maybe all the fatigue I've experienced is merely an excuse that the ego is telling me I need in order to get with the ego's program, which I did in the past and led me astray, severely led me astray, led me into great troubles that I'm still in. I'm not a natural coffee drinker, not at all, but I started drinking caffeine to try to get rid of the fatigue I had, because I thought I had a really important spiritual mission to accomplish. And so I was so tired, I said, how can I get some more energy? Well, I started drinking coffee, and then stronger coffee, then the French press mode of brewing coffee, which is supposedly the strongest, and drinking a lot more. And then I began to get into troubles. And those troubles got deeper and deeper and deeper. And really, really, really got terrible and terrible, more and more and more terrible. So I'm still digging out from that. And it's been about 17, 18 years or so. Amazing. Quite extraordinary. And to see it come back just from drinking that coffee to stay awake, to see all this trends suddenly reappear, I said, wow, that's not a coincidence. That is not a coincidence. It's happened over and over again. There's no question there's an ideology that goes with caffeine. Caffeine has an ideology with it, has a consciousness with it. And this is being reflected in the world now. I believe it's well over 90% of people in the world ingest caffeine every day. In some form. It's stuck. I still feel it in me. It's not good. Drinking a lot of water. Ate a lot of food. Drank a lot of water. Took some vitamins. Drinking some antioxidants, blueberries, etc. And I'll try to, you know, shake this out of my system. But it always feels terrible the next day. I said, wow, this stuff's really more powerful than people realize. They're under the spell. People who are under the spell of drugs don't realize it. The same with marijuana. It has a very powerful spell on those who take it, and it speaks for them. It actually speaks for them. You're not speaking to them. You're speaking to the consciousness of the marijuana, the drug. Absolutely true. And they all tend to say, have the same kind of illogical rationale for continuing on with it. And you realize you're not speaking to a reasonable person at all. Not at all. They're under the influence of this consciousness. Now, of course, this is very iconoclastic to say, because the whole world is governed by this sort of consciousness right now, along with the machine consciousness. Machines too have a consciousness, and they tell us that we have to follow their consciousness. And so people are acting in more and more mechanistic ways. This is what I observed in the Kaiser. It was like an assembly line. It's very mechanistic. Wow. I said, what about the patient? Well, the patient has to fit in with the program. Now, you hear a lot of horror stories about Kaiser, actually. And I can understand why. You go in there for something, you never come out. Because the way it operates. Someone said you have to be very, very pushy and blunt and pushy and stand up for yourself. And it takes a certain kind of personality to be able to deal with this. And I saw that. But just comparing it to the way medicine used to be, wow. Holy cow. You are just you're in the machine. And they're expanding like crazy. Everyone tells you, get Kaiser. No way. And the advertisements they have are fascinating. There's this woman, she's been on it for years and years and years and years, and she gives a spiel that talks about how proactive like Kaiser is for making sure you stay healthy. And I'm so sick of those advertisements. I just can't stand them. I said, there's something phony about all this. Well, you go in there, and you that's the image you think. It's not that really that way at all, actually. That's just a misleading image that they're presenting. And the doctors and staff, they're not high quality, really. They're bottom of the barrel, actually. It's a business. And I'm not just singling out Kaiser. This just happened to be my experience. I'm not in the habit of going into hospitals, although I have had to be in some to accompany other people quite a bit, unfortunately. I found other hospitals to be different. I found like the Catholic-run hospitals. They run a lot of hospitals. I found them to be much more compassionate in connecting with the patients. Different value system, to say the least. So, hospitals different, healthcare systems different, no question about it. But the emphasis on pharmaceuticals is extraordinary. My gosh. Again, this world is nothing but an excuse. That spirit is just imagining this excuse. Blaming us. Well, blaming the body, blaming the person. There is no real us. We just, spirit says there is. So spirit believes there's a separate I. And it's blaming the separate I for its own failure. It's saying, no, it's not spirit that's trying to change God. It's this I. It's the humans. They're the ones. who are failing. They're the ones that is fearing punishment from God, so it projects punishment onto these eyes, these personalities, these bodies, these people that it's imagining, like a dream. Is imagining a dream, you're imagining someone is responsible for the failure of the dream to be real, and then you then punish these dream figures in a dream for failing to accomplish making the dream real. I mean, this is how crazy it is, actually. And I thought maybe I should stand in front of, you know, these tech companies, Facebook, Google, whatever, with a selfie and do this, you know, this hangout here, spiritual gym. But I don't want to be hanging out in those places. That doesn't do me any good at all. It's grandstanding. Why shouldn't I go to a place I really love? And then you're going to get a much more powerful feeling. That might get the drama queens watching the videos, but they're not really interested in truth and salvation in the first place. So how does that benefit anyone? It's a lose-lose proposition. But caffeine saying, hey, why don't you go to San Francisco, hang out there in the coffee shops there and just watch, you know, tape the scene just going by. This is where caffeine feels comfortable. So caffeine says, hey, I'd feel more comfortable if you take me to San Francisco. I say, I'm not taking you there. And then caffeine says, I don't like where I am. Interesting, huh? Consciousness of the drug wants us to hang out where the drug feels comfortable. Now, very interesting. Take a patient to hospital, for example, which I experienced today, without giving anything away. Let's just say that if someone was taking a certain drug, or drugs, but a certain drug, let's say, maybe, let's say that drug feels most comfortable hanging out in a hospital. Guess where the patient finds himself? In a hospital. Very compelling, iconoclastic talk, isn't it? For me, it's also just like, wow. Now I've told the Holy Spirit to evaporate, ease off all insanity, all sanity, the symptoms of insanity, across the board, all of them without any exception. Well, where am I going to find myself then? Where am I going to hang out? This is intriguing, is it not? Is it intriguing enough for any of us to try? I'm certainly going to try. I'm intrigued by this. What other influences are we under where these influences are saying where they like to hang out? But that's not necessarily in our best interest at all. Don't you get this feeling sometimes like you're hanging out with somewhere, but you feel like, I don't really want to be here. This is not where I really want to be. I don't really understand why I'm here. Some part of me seems to want to be here, but I don't really want to be here. Why? Why is that happening? Could it be that we're under the influence of something, and that wants to hang out and has convinced you that this you're going to be happy, because it's happy. You're going to be happy, but you're not. So I wonder, what are we under the influence of that is telling us we need to hang out in this world? Is there something we're under the influence of that says, hey, I really like to hang out on planet Earth and hang out with a body on planet Earth, so you'd be happy there too, so this is what you need to do. Maybe we're just hanging out with a body on planet Earth because we're not under the influence of something. Just like hanging out in the hospital under the influence of some drug, we can just say, hey, wait a minute. If I'm not under the influence of that anymore, I say, hey, I don't want to hang out with a body on this planet. I want to hang out in the death-free realm or something like that, you see. as a light body. Maybe our light body is just hanging out with this body in a world because it's under the influence of something or imagining itself to be. But we're really just a light body. And ultimately, even beyond that, completely formless, but from a pragmatic continuity fear standpoint, let's say we're just really just a light body hanging out with this flesh body in a world where, just like someone taking a drug finds himself hanging out in a hospital with doctors and nurses poking them, constantly poking them and saying, we need more tests, we need to do this, we need to do that. So you see, everything is grist for the mill in terms of awareness, spiritual awareness here. You spend the day traveling and hanging out in the hospital and come back and you look at it and say, hey, wait a minute. You know, what does the Holy Spirit have for me? How does it interpret the day? So always ask the Holy Spirit, how do you want me to interpret the day? I know you have my best interests clearly in your mind. Holy Spirit is always absolutely clear about our best interests. So it only serves our best interests. So it doesn't hurt to ask the Holy Spirit, you know, how do you see this, Holy Spirit? How would you, what would you suggest to me to maybe look at it this way, look at it this way? What do you, right? Beautiful day driving a lot of clouds. Wow, winter clouds. Some of them are quite spectacular, driving through sort of a delta area with water in the bay and, you know, the backlighting of the sun. Wow, spectacular, some of the scenery we saw today. Winter scenery driving through the Bay Area. Wow. But it just is what it is. Under the influence, huh? Wow. So this is resonating. This, and I'm feeling the wow of it. This is really quite a large step forward. Or maybe a hop forward. We always used to do the standing broad jump when we were testing us in athleticism. I remember that. They said that's a great test of athleticism. How far can you just leap standing both feet, you know, feet together than just leaping? So I used to practice that a lot. I tried to say, how can I? I was pretty very good at it, actually. But it's tough. And you look at it now, how far can I hop now? Oh my gosh, I mean, it's not very far. What happened to the springiness under the influence of the body, huh? So the Holy Spirit can evaporate whatever the influence is. And we may start realizing, hey, wait a minute. Just like I'm in the hospital, say, hey, wait a minute. I think it's time to go. I don't want to hang out in the hospital. I felt no desire to hang out in the hospital whatsoever. In a bed. I mean, I didn't mind visiting a friend there and cheering him up and paying attention to what's going on. Say, huh, was, wow. But as far as me going to be in a hospital bed, I didn't feel any pull to that at all. Or being in a hospital, nothing. Nothing at all. Having doctors come in, nurses attend you, I never, no interest. Probably then won't end up in a hospital, right? But I think ending up in San Francisco doing a selfie movie with a selfie stick might be worse than being in a hospital. And that's what the caffeine was telling me. Hey, you should go do this. Yeah, that'd be really cool. You can drink some coffee, that'll get you fired up and enough courage to do it. I said, wait, just a minute. Is that really wise? Is that a genius move, or is that just a smart move that's really stupid? So we have to go lickety-split right now. I have stuff coming up that I don't want to I'm not attracted to at all. So there must be something that I'm still under the influence of that's attracted to that, and it's pulling me along, saying, "Hey, this is what you got to do." I said, "Well, no, I don't want to do that." And just like the caffeine is still demanding, it's very demanding, and it gradually wears off. Then you see the demand vanishes once this drug wears off. The demand is gone. Just like that, we need to have something, influence of something, ease up on us. This is why I ask the Holy Spirit, ease up all influences upon us, except your own. Back up, ease up all influences upon us, Holy Spirit, except your own influence. How about that for an even better prayer? Every day it seems like we get even better prayers. Holy Spirit, without making any exception, ease up all influences upon me except your own influence. Wow. Let's find out where then, what do we feel attracted to then? Wow. Sunday morning is a great time to drive. Early Sunday morning, there's no cars on the road. You have these massive 10-lane freeways, smooth as silk. There's nobody on them, and it was enjoyable that way. Coming back Sunday afternoon wasn't so enjoyable. I think we may have beat the traffic coming back from various places, but wow, in the morning time, people sleep in on Sunday. So these subtle influences, saying, maybe it's some consciousness of food or something. Say, hey, I know where you can get some great food. You gotta hang out with a body in a world and eat all this stuff. And it's some sort of consciousness that's wants to do that and tells us to hang out in such a situation. Tells spirit to hang out in a body, in a world, body, food. The East call it samskaras or karma or whatever. There's these subtle influences, like a drug. Keep wanting to hang out somewhere and they want to go there. We have to say, no, you go ahead, I'm not going to go there. So Holy Spirit, without making a single exception, ease off all influences upon me except your own. Back off all influences upon me except for your own. Wow, I love this prayer. It seems to be a very hopeful prayer. Affirmation. Which in itself is a sign that a lot of influences have backed off. Been backed off here. It's funny, when I was buying that coffee drink, there was a kid, a man with his son, little son, riding on his shoulders in the store. And they walked past him, and the kid was going, "Stop, don't, stop, don't, stop, don't." And I heard that. I said, wow, I'm not supposed to get anything. But then again, I said, you know, I don't want to fall asleep either. But so there must be a better way. There has to be a better way here. And I don't get tired. But at least it entered my consciousness enough so I threw away about a third of it. When I got home, I just threw it away. I was tempted. The caffeine said, no, finish it. Drink it all. And I got a warning. Say, hey, don't drink it. You won't be able to sleep. And then went and I said, you're right. Poured it in the sink. And I said, that's forget it. It did its job. Just a little bit enough to kind of somehow do its job, which makes me think that the fatigue is somehow linked with it again. That fatigue is trying to sabotage us, give us an excuse. It's like spirit making an excuse. I very much feel that way. that's the number one problem I've had in my life, is severe fatigue. And now we may be seeing what it is. It's part of the excuse-making scheme of spirit, of trying to get us to identify with bodies and world. Because whatever I take to get rid of fatigue, it hooks me into bodies in the world. Again, fatigue may be just an excuse, a pretense entirely, which means it could vanish. We can back off of it. Holy Spirit, without making any exception, back up all influences upon me, except your own influence. So when you get down to this depth, it's important to just take your time. We just take our time here, not in too much of a rush. Because this is extraordinarily consequential. When you start seeing the cause of fatigue, that is very, very consequential. And again, don't panic and try to grab hold of it. Oh, this is so important. I've been exhausted my whole life, and now I think I see. Well, just get comfortable. This is just a new normal. Hanging out here is just a new normal. This is the way to do it. Be intrepid and be a genius. Don't try to grasp it, because then you'll start struggling. Sneeze tried to hit me real hard. Whew. I had to just put all effort into that, willful effort, to for that to be dissipated. Wow. Whew. Don't struggle with it. Don't try to grasp. Just the new normal is to be aware of this. Just to be aware of it. Just to recognize it, okay? It's part of the excuse-making mechanism, that's all it is. Try to hook me into bodies in the world. Worry about how to get rid of it, what to do about it. Just, it's enough. For the new normal is just to be comfortable with this awareness. That's all. Say, okay, that's what it is. I'm comfortable seeing that. I'm not making any decisions right at this point. I'm just seeing it. I'm not going to be for it or against it. I am for seeing it. Okay. But as far as what to do about it, I'm for not taking a position yet. So we're not really neutral. There's no neutral thoughts, but what you say, we're for not taking a position. That's still a thought, right? My thought is I have the thought of not taking a position on this right now. My gosh, just think all the buildings today. I haven't been up in a certain area for a long time. Good Lord, it's so many buildings. Square, rectangular, angular buildings, everywhere, just plopped down in this flat land, just nondescript. And everywhere is the same. These strip malls are the same everywhere. It's like, wait a minute, where am I? And we were driving around. I said, you know, I don't know where I am. I don't really know where I am at all. But it just all looks the same. It could be any place. There's just these anchor stores and these strip malls, you know, these various stores, and they're all over the country, I guess. This is just everywhere. So the architecture is the same. And it's just like, you say, where's the culture? There's no culture here. And then these huge tract home, you know, subdivisions, I guess you call them, of tract homes, just nice kind of homes, but just out in the middle of nowhere. There's zero culture there. There's just like, where is the culture here? There's nothing. Wow. I can't believe it. I think the culture here is driving to work and driving back home and going to the market and raising a family, and that's pretty much the culture. And taking medicines. I really see that taking medicines is the culture, certainly of the United States, and I think it's pretty much globally. Is I know I've said to some medical people that I don't take anything, and I've taken my life virtually nothing for a long time, nothing at all, no procedures, taken nothing for a long time. Certainly no surgical procedures ever had, except extracting a tooth, yeah. But so I'm like as clean can be. The thought of taking some medicine just never even occurs to me. And they say that is absolutely extraordinary. They say it's just like this, just like so rare, just like amazing. I say, huh, what do you mean? They say, oh yeah, everybody's taking some, everybody's getting procedures done, everybody's this and that. I said, what? But it never occurs to me that people do this stuff. But why would they do that? it just, my consciousness just does not even reflect that, really. I just kind of puzzle, what are you taking, why? It's an excuse. It's part of the excuse dynamic. But truly, it's amazing listening to the dialogues of everything. And oh yeah, well, I got out of this, I take this. Well, I got to take this, I take this. But then I have a problem with this, I take that. So I switch over to taking this. Okay, I take that. And everybody's very conversant about pharmaceuticals now, aren't they? Everybody. They're all experts at it, seems like. Who doesn't carry some sort of pharmaceutical with them in some way, right? Or this prescription over the counter. I don't have anything. Although I got some capsaicin, had a sore muscle in my calf muscle last night. I said, well, I gotta be driving a lot tomorrow. Maybe I better do something about it. I thought, well, capsaicin is helpful, so I put this capsaicin on, but it's very powerful capsaicin. My calf was like it was on fire. I had to get up in the middle of the night and go in and take soap and water to it and try to get rid of it, and that didn't work. And I said, I can't sleep. I got this long trip and I can't sleep because my leg feels almost like taking a blowtorch to it. It was horrible. And then I said, Holy Spirit, please, without any exception, ease off all symptoms of insanity. And I kept repeating that. You know what? I didn't feel the fire anymore. And I went to sleep. And I slept soundly. It was a fact. Until the alarm woke me up. I didn't think I'd be able to sleep at all. It was just excruciating. So it was a great way to test out this prayer. It worked. It certainly worked. I was just not even hardly aware. It was just this gradual phasing out of the awareness of this, the pain and the agony of it. And I just sort of, my attention just no longer went there, and I just fell asleep, slept well. So Holy Spirit, without making a single exception, ease off all influences upon me, except your own influence. This is interesting. This is not intriguing. You say, well, I wonder where this path will take me. And of course, the influences are saying, wow, I want you to go down that path. I'm not comfortable going down that path. Keep in mind that people are taking all sorts of medicines, whether it be birth control, you know, steroids, of all sorts of types of things, that they just start them, you know, as a matter of course. This has had an incredible impact upon the world. Devastating impact. It's interesting that the Catholic Church forbids birth control. There's wisdom in the great traditions of this planet that we don't understand very well. But certainly, wait a minute.
Yeah. Okay. Can you take some for it? Huh?
An emergency there. Oh boy. You see? There you go. But the culture now of just the ease of dispensing medicines, and starting with mothers and their children, is just extraordinary. Mothers used to tell their children to pray. Let's all pray together. Let's all ask Jesus to help us out. Let's ask the Holy Spirit to help us out here, to ease the symptoms, ease all influences upon us. Ease, you know, help diminish all influences upon us, except your own influence. And they have applied some basic folk medicine. A lot of that actually is very effective. As you know, there's something to believing in what you're doing also. There seems to be some sort of a medical emergency. Not a surprise. This is the way things go. It's very, very interesting. But I've said a lot, and maybe enough to really stun the ego and get our interest up, right? Get our curiosity piqued. Holy Spirit, diminish all influences upon me except your own influence. And having curiosity about this path, let's go down this path and see what happens. How about a little intrepidness here? Right? That's more intrepid than going into San Francisco and making a selfie video, isn't it? Way more intrepid. So that's what we're going to do. Okay, so very great. Stay tuned here to this. Keep your spiritual workouts going here, because we have some very interesting perspective here to share, don't we? Okay, very great. That's it.